Hello, I'm Micah Smith from Denver 7, and welcome to Denver Decides. This community partnership is dedicated to accessible and transparent elections. This partnership includes the League of Women Voters of Denver, Inter-Neighborhood Cooperation, and is presented by Denver 8 TV. Our mission today is to present a candidate forum in anticipation of the general election coming up on Tuesday, November 3rd. Among other offices, this election includes the candidates vying to represent constituents in Colorado's State House of Representatives from District 9. District 9 is located in the southeast corner of Denver. Our format is a pretty standard one. We will begin with opening statements that will be followed by rounds of questions that have been submitted by the organizers of this forum. Since we do have a time limit, we may not be able to get to all of these submitted questions. All of the candidates will answer all questions, and all of their responses will be timed. So let's begin by meeting the candidates vying to represent Colorado State House District 9 as your next state representative. The candidates are standing left to right facing the audience in the order that their names will appear on the November ballot. So beginning at my right is Larry Braig, and my left is Emily Sirota. Welcome both of you to this forum. And one more note to the candidates on behalf of our viewers, we sincerely urge you to be honest, direct, and forthright to help voters distinguish one candidate from another. We will begin with 1 minute opening statements from each candidate, and we will proceed in ballot order with these statements. So once again, starting at my right, Larry Braig will begin with your opening statement.
Hello, and thank you, Micah, Denver Channel 8 Consortium. My name is Larry Braig. I'm running for state representative out of House District 9 because I believe my personal story and my life experience give me a unique insight to the problems facing our people in the state today. I was raised in North Denver by a black stepfather. I graduated from Denver Public Schools, And my small family has experienced racism, drug addiction, homelessness, and prison system. My 34-year career as a Denver firefighter put me in every neighborhood in the city and in touch with thousands of people that relied on me to help solve an infinite number of problems and emergencies that they face in their street and their homes. I didn't do it alone. I had co-workers that were committed to a system that works. That's what I expect to find at the State House, committed system in a belief in a system that works for everybody and not just a select few. Thank you.
Thank you, Larry. And now, an opening statement from Emily Sirota.
Good evening, and thank you to Micah, the League of Women Voters, Channel 8, and the INC. I'm Emily Sirota, and I'm running for re-election as your state representative. I'm a mom and a social worker, and I ask for your vote because while we've accomplished a great deal in the last 2 years, still much work remains. We're facing concurrent crises in COVID, the economy, and even an erosion of our democracy. These are immensely difficult times we are living through. These times require leadership that puts the needs of Colorado families and its workers first. These times require a belief in science, a commitment to face these challenges head on, and the fortitude to live our values through the work that we do. I will continue to fight for the healthcare and public education systems we deserve. I will continue my work on climate policy, early childhood education, and more. I ask that you reelect me as we navigate these most challenging times together in order to rebuild our Colorado way of life.
Thank you, Emily. Now, our first questions for the candidates, and each candidate will have 1 minute to answer. We will start in reverse order from the opening statements. We will begin with Emily Sirota. Emily, give us examples of the sorts of bills you would draft to make a significant impact on Colorado's jobs and economy.
We are facing a crisis with our state budget. We just had to slash $3.3 billion from the state budget in the coming year, and we are expected to face even more cuts ahead. These kinds of cuts will devastate our economy as our school systems, our transportation systems, our healthcare systems will suffer from these cuts. I will be working to ensure that we have a more fair tax code that ensures special interests are paying their fair share so that we are able to invest in our communities, in our schools, in our healthcare systems, in housing and public education.
Let's turn to Larry Braig for his answer to that question.
Thank you, Micah, again. This is an unprecedented year. As a 34-year veteran of the Denver Fire Department, I thought I'd seen a lot of things. And I've never seen anything like this year now. And what I worry about is legislation that comes out in a year like 2020 that affects businesses, homes, education, healthcare, everything down the line. And that's what I worry about, is over legislation in a time that we should really be pumping the brakes and trying to hold things back and seeing how the lay of the land and maybe this time next year. Thank you.
Now our next question for our candidates, and we'll begin with Larry for this one. Name two substantive issues that you pledge to reach across the aisle to the other party to work on for Colorado.
Thank you. I would definitely be reaching across the aisle on regards to oil and gas. And I feel that oil and gas has been unfairly portrayed as the evil in climate change. I feel that there's definitely a way to have affordable, safe, clean energy that takes a little bit of everything from above: solar, wind, hydropower, and natural gas. I understand coal may be an issue. That would be one of the things I'd be reaching across the aisle on. And the second one would be to safeguard our society against an introduction of hard drugs and legalization of hard drugs in our society. And I would ask all members in the House and the Senate to work with me in this regard.
All right, thank you, Larry. And Emily, your opportunity to answer that question.
Thank you, Micah. I believe two areas where we have been able to work well together between Republicans and Democrats is around the issue of criminal justice reform. I believe that both sides of the aisle recognize the immoral state of affair that is our criminal justice system right now, the amount of money that is spent incarcerating people in Colorado and across this country for that matter, as well as substance use issues and trying to bring resources to our communities all across the state, urban, rural, suburban, to address these issues with substance use.
Right. Thank you, Emily. And you will be first to answer this next question. Give one or two ideas by which you think the state legislator can improve the affordability of housing.
We actually have done a tremendous amount of work at the legislature in order to create a trust fund that will support the creation of more affordable housing across Colorado. One thing that can also be done that remains is to adjust our laws so that local governments are better able to address affordable housing in ways that their hands are tied right now, so that, for example, they are able to require a certain amount of affordable housing to be able to be built when new projects are being built that that localities have jurisdiction over. I think that is an important step forward.
Now, Larry, your answer to that question.
Thank you. That's a very important issue because it's, I'm out knocking doors in my district now talking to people. That's one of the main issues that's come up, and at the Denver City Council is introducing a zoning change to all neighborhoods in the city, an unfair zoning change, and it's framed as an affordability issue. In reality, the fine print introduces a lot of other things into the neighborhoods. But I would talk to Denver in particular. I watched today a demolition of a huge block of buildings that have been there longer than I've been in Southeast Denver, 27 years, and huge plot of ground that could be easily built into affordable housing, and it's not that far of a stretch. It's walkable, it's easy to do. There's similar buildings, catty corner to where they're being torn down now. So I think the city of Denver has a lot to do with it in that they've had an opportunity to build affordable housing and it hasn't been done.
Now let's continue with our questions for the candidates vying for the State House of Representatives seats from District 9. Larry, you will answer this one first. If you could change one current Colorado law, which one would it be? How would you change it and why?
I would change the law that restricts parental rights to help their children access health care in regards to mental health care. That's one of the things that got me interested in running was that as a parent, if I had a problem with my child, that I would be restricted, or the doctor rather would be restricted in helping my child resolve what could be a problem that could be easily resolvable. So that would be my main issue. Yes, ma'am.
Now, Emily, your answer to that question.
I would repeal Tabor. Tabor has placed the Taxpayer Bill of Rights, which has placed a completely irrational stranglehold on the ability of Colorado to properly manage its finances. And Colorado is a cautionary tale to every other state in the nation. No other state has passed this legislation because of the havoc that it has wreaked on our budget. And we now have an incredibly regressive taxation system in the state whereby low and middle income Coloradans pay a larger share of their income in taxes than the wealthy and the well-connected.
Next question from our sponsoring partners, and we begin with Emily Sirota. What are the most pronounced similarities and differences between yourself and your opponent?
I don't know Larry very well, but what I do know of him, I believe that we are probably very similar in our love for our family and our closeness to our family, and wanting to do what we believe is best for the state of Colorado. I think that there are probably a number of differences in terms of how we approach what is best for Colorado. I don't know what his stance is. Maybe we'll find out on our system of taxation, on what he believes in terms of the right of health care for all. Certainly there is a difference of opinion in terms of what fossil fuels mean for our climate. Those are probably some pretty clear differences.
Larry Braig, your answer to that question.
Thank you, and Emily, I appreciate that. And I think we are similar a lot in that we love Denver and we love the state. And the biggest difference is, you know, I've been here a little longer and I've seen Denver as it was and what it can become and the potential that Denver has. That's probably the biggest difference, that, you know, raised in Denver, lived in Denver, and worked in Denver for a long period of time. That's the biggest difference. And yes, we'll have some differences on the issues, and I appreciate that, and that's the way it's supposed to go. But I do not dislike you at all, and that is my answer. Thank you.
Now, the next question for our candidates, and Larry, you will answer this one first. Gentrification and home affordability has become a major issue in our city. What can be done at the state level to help?
I'm not sure at the state level, being so new at it, but Denver has been, again, I say Denver has had ample opportunity for, I can say honestly, 15 years to address the affordability issue, and they haven't done that. And the prime example coming up is the Globeville-Swansea area with the I-70 project coming up. And that area is just going to be taken advantage by investors and developers. And before you know it, those people will be pushed out looking for affordable homes themselves. And ironically, one of the affordable home sites being built there is going to be built in the Globeville-Swansea area. So it's as far as from a state level, I'm not really sure because I'm so new at the game yet, but I will find out.
Emily, your answer to that question.
Thanks, Micah. Well, at the state level, one of the important things the state can do is to distribute resources to to the counties across Colorado to address affordable housing, and we have set up a fund to do so. Of course, there's never enough, but another thing that the state can also do is to address this issue of local preemption, not allowing local governments to address affordable housing in the way that makes sense for particular local governments. And part of that also has to do with Tabor, which I will go back to, which restricts the way in which local governments may fund affordable housing projects. And so if we could simply repeal that, or if at the state level we could, if we weren't talking about Tabor, just give local government some of the more tools to be able to address what makes sense in each city and county.
And we will move on to our next round. This is what we call our lightning round. Our candidates will be asked to answer questions. I read with a simple yes, no, or pass. It goes quickly, so listen closely. And remember, your answer can only be yes, no, or pass. We will go in left to right order as the candidates face the audience. Larry, then Emily. Did you attend or participate in any of the organized demonstrations or events in downtown Denver in late May and early June? Larry.
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. For this election, will you use the U.S. Postal Service to mail your ballot? Larry.
No.
Emily.
No. But I love the Postal Service.
No, yes. No or pass. Marijuana has been legal in Colorado for nearly 8 years. Have you personally consumed some of the products available in our state, Larry?
Yes.
Yes.
Do you currently own or do you plan to own an electric car?
No.
Yes.
Should state legislators work at the Capitol longer than 5 or 6 months?
Yes.
Yes.
These forums will be on replay through Election Day for future viewing audiences. We are recording this in late September. Do you think kids should be in school buildings right now?
Yes.
Yes.
Have you recently done any volunteer work in your neighborhood or elsewhere in the city?
Yes.
Yes.
Do you support allowing nonviolent low-level felons to leave state prisons right now due to COVID?
No.
Yes.
Does life begin at conception?
Yes.
No.
Do you or any family member own a licensed firearm?
Yes.
No.
Do you own season tickets for any of Denver's major sports teams?
No.
No.
Do you think the current state house is listening to its constituents?
No.
Yes.
Was Ronald Reagan right when he said that, quote, the 9 most terrifying words in the English language are, I'm from the government and I'm here to help, and that is the last question for this round.
Yes.
No.
All right. Good job, candidates. Thanks for those quick answers. For the next few rounds of questions, it's going to be the candidates' turn to ask the questions of one another. Each of you will ask your opponent a question, and hopefully they will have an answer for you. We will begin in reverse ballot order, so we begin with Emily Sirota. Emily, you will ask Larry a question, and Larry, you will have 1 minute to answer.
Okay.
Larry, do you believe that your party should reject QAnon as a conspiracy theory?
No, I don't. I've heard of QAnon. If it was so widespread, I think I would have heard of it now. And I don't believe that's a party policy to believe in QAnon. So, no.
Now, Larry, it's your turn to ask a question to Emily.
Emily, I've heard you say our system is broken. In Colorado, the Democrats have been in power since 2006. Do you consider the Democratic Party to be broken? If so, what would you replace them with?
I believe that many systems in this country are broken right now. For example, I support Proposition 113, the National Popular Vote, which is a bill that I passed, and I'm asking for a yes on National Popular Vote for the voters to reaffirm Colorado entering that that agreement because I believe every vote should count equally. And right now, we have had two out of the last five presidents become elected while receiving second place in the popular vote. And so the popular vote is one thing that I think is our electoral college system, I believe, is broken. And the popular vote is a possibility for this country going forward. And I believe that campaign finance reform is critical to fixing our broken system. Corporations are not people, and money has way too much influence over the entire system in this country.
Now, Emily, another question from you for Larry.
Scientists tell us that climate change will have catastrophic effects on the survival of Earth as we know it. Do you believe the overwhelming majority of climate scientists who say that human activity over the last 50 years has warmed our planet? And what do you believe is the role of the Colorado legislature to address it?
Thank you. I'm a little bit older than you. And when I was growing up, it was a fear of global cooling and people worrying about an ice age, a new ice age coming along. And then it changed to global warming, and now it's climate change. I believe that science in this area is inexact, and living in Colorado as long as I've seen the ebb and flows of our seasons that people newer to the state could consider as being abnormal. I do believe the climate is changing, though, and I think that we can work together from the state legislature to come up with programs that don't affect our economy and don't cast a prejudice on one oil and gas, for instance, that casts them in a bad light and being the boogeyman in climate change. But we all have to work together in this, because I've been recycling and conserving as long as I've been alive. Thank you.
All right, Larry, your turn to ask Emily another question. And Emily, you have 1 minute to answer.
Thank you. Crime is up all across Denver, especially in the underserved communities of Montbello, Five Points, and Capitol Hill. Knowing that, do you still feel voting to defund the police was the right thing to do?
I don't know who voted to defund the police. I think that that phrase means different things to different people. What I believe is that we should be investing more in mental health services. We should be investing more in housing affordability. We should be investing more in making sure that people have the supports in our community to live the lives that they deserve. And so I don't think that defund the police means the same to everyone. What I have heard from a number of my constituents is they would rather see a prioritization of funds so that less money is going toward policing and more money is going toward supportive community services.
And that brings us to an end of our Q&A segment, and we move now to closing statements. Each candidate will have 1 minute for a closing statement, and we will reverse the order of the opening statements, which means we will begin with Emily Sirota. Ms. Sirota, you have 1 minute for your closing statement.
I first ran for office in 2018 because the crises we faced were too great to ignore. And I'm proud of the work that we've done over the last 2 years to tackle climate change and the environment, economic inequality, early childhood and K-12 education, healthcare, workplace rights, campaign finance reform, gun violence, and more. We now find ourselves in uncharted territory, facing a global pandemic resulting in public health and economic crises of unprecedented scale. I know these are scary times. I know that the problems we faced before the pandemic didn't go away, and many have been exacerbated. These crises require innovative thinking. We must resist efforts to recreate the very systems that created the inequities this pandemic has placed in such stark relief. I ask for your vote for re-election to the Colorado Legislature so that together we can work to rebuild a society that ensures racial, economic, environmental, and social justice for all.
And now a closing statement from Larry Braig.
Thank you. My family came to Denver in 1967, and the first black person I'd ever met was my stepfather. As an 8-year-old boy, All I saw was the father that I needed at the time. Growing up with him brought out a sense of fairness and justice in me that's never gone away. Being a firefighter tapped another quality that I had, and that was helping people and making their lives better and keeping them safe. I took every class available to help me do that until I was the one teaching the classes. I still feel the need to fulfill what's been hardwired inside me, and by working for you as your state representative, you'll have found a diamond in the rough, ready to study and learn a different kind of service in the public trust. There's a saying in the fire service, and that's never forget who you're working for. And what that's always meant to me is this: it didn't matter what my beliefs are, and it shouldn't matter to me what your beliefs are. If I was to do my job the way it was supposed to be done, and that's the way I'll represent Southeast Denver. Thank you.
Thank you, Larry and Emily, for participating in this forum. And thank you to our Denver Decides partners, which include Interneighborhood Cooperation and the League of Women Voters of Denver. Denver Decides is presented by Denver 8 TV. Remember, the election day is Tuesday, November 3rd. Make sure your voice is heard, be sure you are registered, and be sure to vote. For complete election information online, go to denverdecides.org. I'm Micah Smith from Denver 7 News. Thanks for joining us.